And finally, in our number one spot, the number one comic book coming out of the 1980s is... Hello to all of my 80s comic book aficionados, Dante D here, and welcome to the channel where we talk about comic books and other geek stuff. Early on in my YouTube career, I posted a video called the Top 20 Best Comic Books from the 1980s, and today I kind of just wanted to remake that video. The original video, yes, I'll still leave it up, but it was early on in my YouTube days when I didn't really have much of an understanding on how to make videos. People were leaving comments that you could see up my nose, and yeah, so I decided to redo it so you wouldn't have to look up my nose anymore. So all of the books that appeared in the original video will also be appearing in this video. This video is essentially just going to be a remake. Haven't really changed much from the original, except that hopefully the quality is updated. So the 80s was a larger than life era in the 20th century. The 80s is known for its amazing styles, its big muscles in all the movies, the corny action movies. I love the corny action movies, but also the iconic comics that came out of that era. So in this list today, you're going to be seeing the top 20 best comic books of the era. Now, I just wanted to let you know in advance, this list will not include The Dark Knight Returns and Watchmen. We all know those were probably the most popular and the best books of the 1980s, and they were watershed. However, this book is going to relate specifically to comic book issues. Dark Knight and Watchmen were released in Prestige Edition, and they were more meant to be graphic novels rather than your typical comic books. So let's get right into this. In our number 20 spot, we have Daredevil Born Again. And this is the first issue of the Daredevil Born Again run by the legendary comic book creator, Frank Miller. This is Daredevil number 227. The Daredevil Born Again run is solid. It is absolutely amazing. Frank Miller was known for his legendary run on Daredevil in the early 1980s, where he introduced the character Elektra. After Frank Miller left Daredevil for a bit, I think the sales kind of tapered and plummeted a little bit. So in the later 1980s, Marvel brought him back to do another run just to kind of boost the sales. And Frank Miller definitely lived up to his hype on Daredevil, because this is probably one of the best books coming out of the 1980s. Number 19, we have The Amazing Spider-Man Annual number 21. This features the wedding of Peter Parker and Mary Jane Watson. I've said this before, but I really think that there's a little bit of gimmicking going on with this book. The 1980s is the era where people really started looking at comic books as collectibles. All these newspaper articles and news stories on TV were coming out saying that comic books were a great investment, and they were featuring all of these comic books that were selling for thousands and thousands of dollars that were released in the 1930s and 1940s. Well, the comic book industry, finally getting wind of that, started doing these special things and these special gimmicky milestones to increase the collectability of particular issues, and this book here was no exception. Now, I have this book, I actually read it. I actually thought it was okay. It wasn't the greatest, but it's definitely worth to add to your collection if you don't already have it. Mary Jane Watson and Peter Parker are the comic book couple of the 1980s. Before, it was always Superman and Lois Lane. I think Peter Parker and Mary Jane have replaced Superman and Lois Lane as the comic book couple. Number 18, Web of Spider-Man number 1. This is a significant book because it is the third Spider-Man solo series, and something significant does happen in this book. This is the issue in which the symbiote that was attached to Peter Parker leaves Peter Parker because he feels rejected. And this is that big bell tower scene that is famous in comic books today. Number 17, Man of Steel, number 1. Now, Man of Steel is a great, great comic book series. And I think it's because John Byrne, who's, for me, one of the rock star artists of the 1980s. I know John Byrne isn't really remembered as a rock star artist, but he really was. He did something amazing with the Superman character. Up until this point, Superman was a character that was really a has-been. No one really cared about Superman anymore. He didn't sell well. He just wasn't on people's radar. John Byrne put Superman back on the map with Man of Steel. Solid run. It's only, I think, 5 or 6 issues, and it's definitely worth to pick up. If you don't have it, you actually could probably find it in your comic book store right now, because and these books are not very expensive. This book here reimagined Superman for a modern age and made him one of the most popular comic book characters again. This was a popularity that continued on into the 1990s all the way up until the death of Superman. Daredevil number 181 is in our next spot, and this features the death of Elektra. Now this spot here should really be tied with Daredevil 181 and Daredevil number 168, which features the first appearance of Elektra. The whole Elektra thing in the early 1980s done by Frank Miller was just really, really hot. Daredevil, which was originally a B-string book, just shot up to popularity and was on many people's pull lists when it hadn't been before. People just loved the character of Elektra, and few issues later, when Frank Miller decided to kill her off in Daredevil number 181, people just went nuts. Now, as we know, characters don't ever stay dead in comic books, so they definitely had to bring her back. Number 15, Kraven's Last Hunt. This is probably one of the best Spider-Man stories ever written, drawn, whatever. This Spider-Man story here, it was written by J.M. DeMatteis, who's one of my favorite comic book writers, and this is not only one of the best comic book stories coming out of the 1980s, it is probably one of the best comic book stories of all time ever published. This was a 6-issue series, which was a crossover, and it was printed in Web of Spider-Man, Spectacular Spider-Man, and The Amazing Spider-Man. Number 14, the new Teen Titans number 1. For people that were growing up in the 1980s, you will remember the new Teen Titans as probably one of the hottest books of the era. Batman, Superman, the household names were not the popular characters of the era. People went for the X-Men. They went for the new Teen Titans. And with George Perez working on this book, you had one of the hottest series of the decade, and it's definitely worth to add to your collection. Incredible Hulk number 340. This book here is one of the hottest just because it features a cover done by a rock star artist. We all know him as Todd McFarlane, and this is just such a cool cover. You have Wolverine on the front with his claws, and in the reflection you can see the Incredible Hulk. It's just amazing, especially because there's a special relationship between the Hulk and Wolverine, and I think it's because Wolverine first made his appearance in a Hulk book. So this particular cover here just captured all that sentimentality and the nostalgia related between these two characters. Number 12, Batman number 404. Here is another Frank Miller book on this list. This is the Batman Year One story. This was a limited 4-issue run. Now, it did appear in the Batman main series. It wasn't published by itself, but this also is remembered as not only one of the best Batman stories ever written, but also one of the best comic book stories of all time. This book is always in print. If you haven't read it, I would really encourage you to go and pick it up either at your local bookstore, or there will be a link in the description where you can pick up your own copy today. Secret Wars number 8. This features the first appearance of the alien symbiote that eventually becomes Venom. Now, this is an iconic cover. Peter Parker's on the front in a black Spider-Man costume. The black Spider-Man costume only makes an appearance at the end of the book. I mean, other than this, Secret Wars is actually a really, really solid run. It's one of my favorite stories ever written. I definitely recommend you pick it up if you haven't read it. This is a great issue to have in your collection, and even if you don't want to collect the individual issues, the trade paperback is solid. There'll be a link in the description if you're interested in picking up a copy. Crisis on Infinite Earths, number 7 and number 8. These are two books that share the same spot because they both feature deaths that were pretty scandalous at the time, but they featured deaths of two significant characters. Crisis on Infinite Earths number 7 is the death of Supergirl. We have Superman on the front with that compelling cover, him holding Supergirl's lifeless body. But also in number 8, we have the death of the Barry Allen Flash. They were just killing everybody in Crisis on Infinite Earths. Now, I have to say, Crisis on Infinite Earths is not my favorite comic book story. I mean, it was okay, but for me, it was actually a little difficult to follow. It's a little convoluted. I get why they wrote the story. This was a story that was meant to kind of solidify DC Comics' continuity, because by this point, they had 50 years of continuity that was all over the place. So they kind of needed something to kind of reset their universe. Now, I'm not as well versed in the DC universe as I am in the Marvel universe. As a matter of fact, the only DC universe that I'm really kind of familiar with is Batman and maybe a little bit of Superman. But other than that, I have no idea. I had no idea really what was going on here. But these books are definitely worth it to have in your collection because they are icons of the 1980s, especially Crisis on Infinite Earths number 7. For many collectors, this is considered to be the end of the Bronze Age of comics and the beginning of what we would call either the Modern Age or the Dark Age of comics. And it really kind of signified that shift to the darkest stories that we have ever seen in comic books. Wolverine number 1. This is Wolverine's first ongoing solo series. Now, believe it or not, this book here is actually Wolverine Volume 2. There was a Wolverine series that predated this one, and we actually will get to that one a little later on in the video. But because this is the first ongoing series for Wolverine, it was definitely an iconic book. By the 1980s, Wolverine was just, an icon for Marvel. People just loved Wolverine. And speaking of Wolverine, in this spot, we have Wolverine Volume 1, Number 1. This is the first Wolverine solo series that only lasted, I think it was only 4 issues. Now, this was Marvel's attempt to kind of experiment a little bit with the Wolverine character. They knew that he was a hot character on the X-Men, but up until this point, we only ever saw him in the X-Men. So, Marvel decided to give him his own solo series to see how he would do as a standalone. And they got Chris Claremont and Frank Miller to work on this book. And it is considered to be one of the best books coming out of the era. Definitely a great, solid read. Would definitely recommend picking up these books to add to your collection if you don't already have them. Now, unfortunately, these books are probably some of the more expensive books coming out of the era. If you're just looking to read the story, a link will be in the description where you can pick up the trade. Batman number 357, another hot book coming out of the 1980s. This is the first appearance of Jason Todd, who eventually becomes Robin. This is also the first appearance of Killer Croc. Great book. It's actually probably one of my favorite books coming out of the era. Love this cover. And Jason Todd, even though he was not liked by a lot of comic book fans, he does play a huge role in 1980s comic book history, as you will see as when we get to what happened to him later on in this video. X-Factor number 1 and number 6. I personally love X-Factor. Now, X-Factor number 1 is the first book that reunites the original X-Men, and X-Factor number 6 is the first appearance of Apocalypse, who is a really cool villain. The reason why I like X-Factor is because by the 1980s, the X-Men books had become really kind of difficult to follow. There were so many different characters that were appearing, and if you were not reading it month to month, it was actually getting really difficult to follow what was going on in the X-Men books. So fans started asking Marvel, like, hey, you know, we really miss the original X-Men. Can you do something about this? They listened to the fans and they brought back the original X-Men, including Jean Grey, who up until this point was actually dead. And in X-Factor number 1, they resurrected her after she had been dead for many, many years. Solid book. Definitely recommend you pick it up. If you're not looking to pick up the individual issues, which probably are not that expensive, I know number 6 will be expensive, but number 1 isn't that bad. But if you're just looking to read, the link will be in the description where you can get the trade. Amazing Spider-Man number 252. This features the first appearance of the black costume in the main Spider-Man series. I think I got that right. I know there's a lot of kind of contention over what the significance of this book is, but it's something like that. Iconic cover, definitely is a homage to Amazing Fantasy number 15, which is the first appearance of Spider-Man. Love this cover, really great to add to your collection. Definitely is a more expensive book, but there are many, many trades that have this story in it, and some of those will be in the description. X-Men number 141, this is the first issue in a 2-issue story arc called Days of Future Past. One is probably one of the most famous X-Men stories ever written, and these covers are just super iconic as well. Batman number 428. This is probably one of my favorites coming out of this era. Batman 428 features the death of the Jason Todd Robin, and this I believe, was the first time in history that a comic book got mainstream media attention. It was all over the news when people got wind of the fact that Robin was killed off. People thought this was the Dick Grayson Robin. You know, it was not specified that this was not Dick Grayson, that this was Jason Todd. And to people, you know, Batman was an establishment and you can't have Batman without Robin. So to kill off Robin was a huge, huge deal. And what I thought was really cool about this book is at the end of it, they leave a phone number where fans could vote if they wanted to keep Robin alive or if they wanted him dead. Now the results were very, very close, but at the end of the day, they ended up killing off Robin. And I actually hear from viewers all the time who tell me that way back when this book came out, they called and they voted to kill Robin. I would really like to hear from you if you're one of those people that actually voted to keep him alive. And if you were one of those people that actually voted to kill him, I would really like to know what your reasoning was, why you wanted to see him die. Number two, we have The Amazing Spider-Man number 300. This features the first appearance of Venom. This is definitely one of the hottest books of the decade. When it comes to the 1980s, it is Teen Titans, X-Men, Venom, and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Like, those were the household names of the 1980s. Amazing Spider-Man 300, super, super expensive book. If you're looking to add it to your collection nowadays, it's really expensive. But if you're just looking to read the first appearance of Venom, there will be a link in the description where you can get the trade. Love, love this book. And finally, in our number one spot, the number one comic book coming out of the 1980s is Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles number one. Now, I know this might be a little contentious. Some people are going to be like, how is TMNT number one in the number one spot? Well, honestly, I don't think there's any other book that could be in this spot just because what this book managed to accomplish in such a short period of time is just uncanny and, frankly, I believe unprecedented. TMNT number one was originally meant to be a parody of like the New Mutants, Daredevil, and Ronin. And it was never meant to be serious, but it ended up rising in popularity and it just took the public by surprise and took the comic book world by surprise. By the end of the 1980s, you had toys, lunchboxes, bed sheets, underwear, TV shows. Like the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles was just everywhere. I remember growing up, I had so much Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles merchandise. It was just a cultural phenomenon. I believe it still is a cultural phenomenon nowadays, but the popularity of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles will probably never be as high as it was in the 1980s, just based on what this book managed to accomplish. Being an independently published book with such a small print run is just unbelievable. And that, in my book, makes it worthy of the number one spot. So that about does it for a video today. Really, really hope that you enjoyed it. Do you agree with this list? Are there any other books that you feel should have been on this list but were not? Would really like to hear from you all in the comments. And as always, this is Dante D signing off. I will see you all in the next episode.